One of the coolest shots in pool is the jump shot, but I find these shots a little overrated, especially with modern day jump cues. To me, jump shots are kind of like the tapping part in a guitar solo. They sound and look really cool, and they seem really difficult, but it's actually pretty easy once you get the technique down. Taking the game into an often unutilized third dimension, the jump shot offers an easy escape from seemingly impossible situations, putting you back in charge of the table and demoralizing your opponent. But if you don't know this shot, it's putting you at a significant disadvantage. The problem is that a lot of people are hesitant to teach someone how to jump. And while there may be a few people out there that just want to hoard knowledge and maintain a competitive advantage, I find it much more common that they're just worried about inexperienced players damaging equipment while they're learning how to do it. The problem is so common that many pool halls have banned jump shots outright to prevent their equipment from getting damaged. Much to the dismay of pool hall owners all around the world, here's my best attempt at a comprehensive guide on how to jump. Once I learned the technique for jumping, which I'll cover later in this video, I caught on very quickly to what I needed to do in different situations to jump over an obstacle and get the cue ball back down to the table before it strikes the object ball. I attribute a lot of this to basic Newtonian physics that I learned in high school. One of the first things that this class covered was basic projectile motion, and a jump shot is a textbook example. I was able to fuse my knowledge of projectile motion with my jumping technique to come up with some very basic rule sets for jumping balls, and I want to quickly cover projectile motion to help you visualize what will happen when you jump. Newton's first law of motion states that an object in motion will stay in motion in the same direction and speed unless acted upon by an outside force. Essentially, if you know an object's direction, speed, and all of the forces that are acting on an object, you should be able to calculate and predict its path, and this is a very simple calculation when discussing jump shots, assuming you aren't playing in a hurricane and wind resistance is negligible. Let's take a look at a basic jump shot and try to see what the path of the cue ball should look like every time that we shoot a shot like this to help us see some patterns and help us visualize every jump shot that we shoot in the future. There are only two variables that we need to know and learn how to control to predict the path of the cue ball. Its initial velocity and the angle at which it leaves the table, or as referred to before, its speed and direction. From these two variables, we can predict the path of the cue ball, learn how to control these two variables, and we can make a variety of jump shots accurately and consistently. In this example, I want to use some nice round numbers to make the calculation easier. So let's say that the initial velocity of the cue ball is 3 meters per second, and the angle that the cue ball leaves the table at is 30 degrees. From here, we can use trigonometry by creating a right triangle to solve for the cue ball's initial horizontal and vertical velocities. The initial velocity of 3 meters per second is the hypotenuse of this triangle, and the angle between the hypotenuse and the adjacent is the angle at which the cue ball leaves the table at, which is 30 degrees. From here, we can use some basic trigonometry to figure out the other two sides of the triangle. Take the two formulas of cosine equals adjacent over hypotenuse and sine equals opposite over hypotenuse, plug in the numbers, and we come up with 2.598 meters per second and 1.5 meters per second. One of the reasons that this problem is so easy to solve and visualize is that our projectile, the cue ball, will be landing at the same height from which it took off every time, assuming we don't jump it off the table. Now that we have the initial vertical velocity, we can calculate a multitude of other things that are important to the shot. The first thing that I want to calculate is how long will it take the cue ball to land back on the table. Since the acceleration of gravity is constant for all objects on Earth, I know that the cue ball will accelerate back down at 9.81 meters per second per second, or meters per second squared. Since the cue ball took off vertically at 1.5 meters per second, I know that it will land traveling at negative 1.5 meters per second. This makes the overall change in speed, or the amount of acceleration that will have to occur caused by gravity, to equal 3 meters per second. Take 3 meters per second, divide it by 9.81 meters per second squared, and you end up with 0.306 seconds. Once this amount of time has passed, the cue ball will have landed back on the table, so we can now calculate to see how far the cue ball has traveled in the horizontal direction before it landed. We can calculate this by taking the initial horizontal velocity and timesing it by the amount of time that passed. 2.598 meters per second times 0.306 seconds leaves us with 0.89 meters. Also, we can calculate the maximum height that the cue ball will have reached. The cue ball will have reached its maximum height halfway through the total amount of time that it took to travel up and back down. This means that the cue ball reaches its greatest height at 0.306 seconds divided by 2, which is 0.153 seconds. Since the acceleration was constant, and we know that the initial velocity was 1.5 meters per second, and the ending velocity at this time was 0 meters per second, we can take the average of these two speeds to calculate the height of the cue ball at the time that it was highest to see if it would have made it over the object ball. Assuming that is that the object ball is under the cue ball at its apogee. 0.75 meters per second is the average speed over the 0.153 seconds that it took to reach its maximum height, which is 0.115 meters, or 115 millimeters. The diameter of a pool ball is 57 millimeters, so we would have about doubled the height of the ball, which leaves us a comfortable cushion to get over the obstacle. Now, in no way am I saying that you should be breaking out your calculator when you go for a shot like this, but rather, there are a few things of note here to remember when planning the path of the cue ball. First, the cue ball will reach its maximum height halfway between where it started and where it initially makes contact with the table again. Second, the second half of the cue ball's path will be a mirror of the first half of the cue ball's path. Third, the greater the angle is that the cue ball leaves the table at, the greater the initial velocity will be in the vertical direction, and the less the velocity will be in the horizontal direction, and also vice versa. Fourth, the greater the initial velocity of the cue ball, or the harder you hit it, the farther and higher it will travel. Now that we have a basic understanding of how the cue ball will travel while it's in the air whenever it is jumped, we can begin talking about how to get it airborne and control the two variables that will determine the path that it will take. But first, I would like to discuss the different kind of cues that are ideal for jumping. When jumping the cue ball, you want energy to be transferred into the cue ball quickly because the amount of time that the cue will be in contact with the cue ball will be much shorter than when compared with a standard stroke. At least that's what I'm assuming, since the cue ball won't be traveling along the same line as the cue hitting it. In order to achieve this quick transfer of energy from the cue to the cue ball, you want a thick shaft that will not bend. If a shaft is thin and bends easily, it will transfer energy to the cue ball more slowly. The tip should also be hard to help transfer the energy into the cue ball as quickly as possible. Think of the difference between hitting a baseball with an aluminum bat and a wooden bat. Now, you can still jump with a standard cue and softer tip, but it isn't nearly as effective. The only time I will jump with my regular playing cue is if I'm only jumping a quarter of a ball and I have plenty of time to get the cue ball high enough. As you can see in the background, I used three different cues and hit at approximately the same speed and angle, and you can see a clear difference in how the cue ball reacts. Next, I would like to cover the technique and form that I use. Now, a lot of people like to use something called the dart technique, but it's something that I've had a hard time staying accurate with and find hard to control. Myself, however, I prefer to hit with the more standard stroke that is simply elevated. I prefer this method because I get to use the same stroke that I have spent years developing, making it much easier for me to control my cue and stay as accurate as possible. It has a few disadvantages, but I prefer this technique. First, let's talk about the bridge that you form. In this, I'm bridging from the rail, but you use the same bridge even if you're bridging off the slate. I keep my pointer and middle finger together and spread out my ring and pinky finger to form a tripod to stabilize the bridge. Extend the thumb out and rest the cue on the fleshy part between your thumb and knuckle, which should form a slight groove for the cue to slide through. This bridge is really no different from what you might do if you were bridging over a ball that was in front of the cue ball. Second, let's discuss how and where to hold the cue. Different elevations will change where you hold the cue. When I'm at max elevation, I'll hold the cue right below the joint. If I'm only slightly elevated, I'll hold the cue farther back. The best way that I can explain where you should hold the cue is that your arm should be bent at 90 degrees when the tip of the cue is just about to contact the cue ball, the same way it would be on a normal shot. The main difference here is that I lock my wrist and grip the cue tightly with my entire hand. This puts more mass behind the cue, which allows the cue to transfer more energy to the cue ball more quickly. Third, let's talk about the stroke. Getting the stroke down is the hardest part about jump shots. But once you get a feel for it, it becomes second nature. I actually had to go shoot a few jump shots just to think about what exactly I was doing. The best way that I can explain it is that it's a snap. You need to accelerate the cue to the desired speed quickly because you're working with a shortened stroke, and then follow through the cue ball. Fourth, let's talk about where to hit the cue ball. At whatever angle you are elevated to, your cue should be placed so that the line that the cue is traveling, if extended, would travel through the center of the cue ball. From there, you can move the cue slightly up for some follow or slightly down for some draw. At max elevation, I'll put, at a maximum, one tip of bottom or top, though it becomes easier to put larger amounts of English the less you are elevated. Next, I want to discuss how you control the angle that the cue ball leaves the table at and its initial velocity. Controlling the speed of the shot is pretty obvious. You just hit it harder or you hit it softer, and there isn't much else to it. Controlling and deciding on the angle, however, is a bit more difficult in practice, But the basic concept is pretty simple. The greater the angle is that you strike the cue ball at, the greater the angle that the cue ball will leave the table at. When executing a jump shot, it is generally best to keep the angle as low as possible for two reasons. The first reason is accuracy. A shot becomes much more difficult when you have to elevate your cue, and the more you elevate, the harder the shot gets. Whether you are shooting off the rail or over the top of another ball, the difficulty of what would normally be a simple shot can be turned into a daunting task. I think the main reason that it is so difficult to maintain accuracy with an elevated cue is that you can't see down the line that you are shooting, making it difficult to check your alignment. Another reason that I think it is so difficult is that a slight amount of left or right can have a masse effect and completely throw off your aim. The second reason I like to keep my cue the least amount elevated as possible is that you want the cue ball to be back down on the table by the time that it makes contact with the object ball. Now, of course, you run the risk of jumping over the object ball and missing it completely, especially if you're trying to do a thin cut, but there are quite a few other risks that players new to jumping might not consider. If the object ball is close to where the cue ball ends up landing, you'll probably end up hitting the object ball on the cue ball's first or second bounce. In this example, I jump over the 10, but the cue ball is still traveling upwards after its first jump and ends up hitting the 8 ball rather thin. Despite hitting the shot with a slight amount of bottom, because of the thin angle that the cue ball hits the 8 at, it ends up following the 8 ball into the corner pocket. Similarly, if you hit the object ball while the cue ball is still in the air, but say it's traveling at a faster speed or the object ball is closer to the edge of the table, you run the risk of knocking the cue or the object ball off the table, which would result in a foul. In order to determine if a jump shot is a viable option in terms of the minimum angle required to get over the problem ball, I like to look at the angle between the bottom of the cue ball and the top of the obstacle. Here our goal is getting over the 8 ball. The angle between the top of the 8 and the bottom of the cue ball is 18 degrees. We want to get completely over the 8 ball, so we need to think about what angle we want the cue to contact the cue ball at. We know that the minimum angle that the cue ball must travel at without accounting for gravity would be a little over 18 degrees. Additionally, I recorded and went through a ton of my own jump shots, and the cue ball was leaving the table at about 10 degrees less than the angle was that my cue was contacting the cue ball at. So if I was aiming at 35 degrees, the cue ball would leave it around 25 degrees. This seemed to stay true as long as I used my jump cue and I was between 20 and 50 degrees elevation. So to send the cue ball at 18 degrees, the cue needs to be elevated to 28 degrees. Add another 7 to 10 degrees or so to account for gravity and to make sure that you get over the ball, and you end up with 35 to 38 degrees. The previous example was to jump over an entire ball, but you don't always have to jump over an entire ball. Sometimes you're only jumping over the edge of a ball. This is much easier to do as the cue ball doesn't have to get nearly as high when you're jumping over a full ball. In order to determine how high you need to jump the ball, look down the line that you are aiming at the object ball and look at where the cue ball would contact the obstacle ball if you weren't jumping it. From that point of where the cue ball would contact the obstacle ball, draw a line parallel to the line that the cue ball is already traveling, and the size of the circle that is made through the obstacle ball is how high the cue ball needs to jump. Keeping in mind the principles that we have already covered, there are times that a jump shot is just not the right choice. One example of this is when the obstacle is so close to the cue ball that there won't be enough room for the cue ball to get over the obstacle in time. I really don't like to elevate above 50 degrees, and keeping in mind that the cue ball will leave the table about 10 degrees under that, and giving another 5 degrees or so to get over the ball for gravity, that means that I typically won't jump anything where the angle between the top of the cue ball and the bottom of the problem ball is greater than 35 degrees. Another time that I try to avoid jumping is if the object ball is too close to the problem ball. I prefer for there to be more room between the obstacle and object ball than there is between the cue ball and the obstacle ball. This gives me the ability to try and time the apogee of the shot above the obstacle ball and gives the cue ball space to land before contacting the object ball. Other times when a jump shot may be inappropriate is if there's a better option on the table. Here you could jump and possibly make the one, but the shot doesn't offer position to the two and you could play an easy kick safe. But this brings me to my next point. A jump shot doesn't always have to be offensive. A lot of times that you're going to be jumping will be in a safety battle. A lot of times you're not going to have an easy pot, but kicking the ball may be extremely difficult. Just because you decide to jump doesn't mean you have to go for the pot. It doesn't mean you have to be aggressive. You can simply try to play it safe. A great example of this is from a recent video I made where Alex Pagulayan plays a jump shot safety against Carlo Beato. He could have just pocketed the ball, but not only was the pocket difficult for a jump shot, but it offered no shape to the next ball. So instead, he decides to jump to get an easy hit and predictably control the cue ball to play an easy safe.
And that's it. Now you know how to jump.